We're live now. That's fantastic. We are live now. I love being live. I love being live better than being walking dead like we all were last night for Halloween.
What are you talking about? You love being Day of the Dead. You I love being dead.
Well, and since I am dead, I can take off my head to recite Shakespearean quotations. That's in honor of Jack Skellington. I'm wearing my Jack Skellington shirt. What does it all mean?
I don't know.
What does it mean? Jack and his existential struggle with understanding Christmas. That's so funny. So funny.
What are you doing?
I'm just saying hello because you just called me just a second ago.
Who called you?
A fabulous person who's going to be on our show today. Hello, Peter. Hi. I'm glad you're there. I'm glad you're ready. We'll be calling you. All the ladies and gentlemen are watching me live, but we haven't connected you yet here. Let me call you back in just a couple of minutes, okay? Oh, okay. Take your time. Take your time. No, we'll just call you in 5 or 10 minutes. Awesome.
Is this any way to
Thank
do
you,
a
Peter.
Show?
Awesome. Bye-bye.
Is this any way to do a show? Welcome to the show, everybody.
Of course it's
this
a way
is
to do a
Torn
show.
Tuesday, your weekly dose of all things Hobbit, Lord of the Rings, and anything related to Tolkien.
And this is how we do our show. This is just
and
how we roll.
We're on Periscope. We're on Twitter right now, so it's wonderful to see all the people show up on Twitter. I'd love to see the hearts. And we're watching the Facebook chat. I see Kay and Chad, Esteban. Hello, everybody.
Mathis, Fokuena, Sarah, on our live. Oh, who was that? Asphaloth.
And our main chat room is at theonering.net/live.
As always.
I see Asphaloth and Fokuena and Coolsville Pinballer.
Always.
Is that a Simpsons reference?
It seems that every week we get more and more platforms. We're on Ustream. We're on Periscope. We're on Twitter Live. And Facebook Live. Are we on Twitter Live as well?
Yeah, we're on Twitter
That's
Live
amazing.
Right now.
We're on Twitter Live.
This is Twitter right now. So
welcome to the show, everybody.
If our eyes welcome. Are everywhere, it's because there's so many chat rooms going on.
Peter's in a cab, and he's racing across town trying to get where he's going.
Peter Jackson?
No, Peter S. Beagle, the author of The Last Unicorn, and also A Fine and Private Place.
Hello, Hobbit Fan Fellowship.
Hello, Hobbit Fan Fellowship. And, of course, he is the author of the Lord of the Rings script in the 70s.
Wait, he wrote Ralph Bakshi's movie?
Are you kidding? Me? We've been talking about that for years.
I just
yes.
wanted to talk over you.
Yeah, of course. I love the way you talk over me, and I love the way you talk over me, too. And everybody loves the way we talk over each other. That's how we roll on Torn Tuesday. This is Justin. I'm Clifford. Welcome again to the show. No, not Peter Jackson. Peter S. Beagle. So any of you fans of The Last Unicorn, one of the coolest, one of the best fantasy stories ever, we're going to talk to the besieged fantasy author, who is, he's in a cab right now, racing across town to get where he's going.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to give him 10 minutes to get settled in, and then we'll call him and have him on the show.
Now
welcome.
Now, I'm totally lame. I don't read. I've never seen The Last Unicorn.
You've never seen this film when you were a kid?
I've only seen the animated Lord of the Rings once. It was kind of weird and creepy. Would I know Peter S. Beagle from anything else? Why is he celebrated? Does he go to conventions? Like, who is this guy?
Of course he is, and of course he does. Everybody who's a Lord of the Rings fan knows him because when you would buy your paperback book in the 70s or the 80s,
paperback writer.
Peter Beagle had his special note and introduction in every American paperback edition. And he's a Tolkien scholar himself. He's a great fantasy author. And you would definitely know his works if you've dabbled into any American fantasy that has come up in the 60s and 70s, particularly famous for writing a book called A Fine and Private Place. He also wrote Laika, the werewolf. And he also wrote Two Hearts, which is the follow-up novel to The Last Unicorn.
So he's a bona fide fantasy author and screenwriter of actual movies that got made. It's not like a young adult author like all these Vergent and Divergent and Mortal.
No. Like Harlan Ellison, he's written for classic science fiction television in the 60s and 70s.
Okay.
He's written for Ralph Bakshi's Lord of the Rings. Now, that script was an interesting project, and we talked about that in our...
You got it, Esteban.
You see our movie here? This is Ringer's Lord of the Fans, and we got a full-on interview with Peter talking about what it was like working for United Artists and making the first adaptation of a Tolkien book into a Tolkien script.
Someone on the chat room just said he worked with Ralph Bakshi and survived.
And survived, even more so, and survived, yes.
Wait, and he worked on Star Trek The Next Generation?
That is correct.
Wait, whoa. That's now you're speaking my language.
Well, the person who's in the chat room, that's Asfaloth. That is Carlene Cordova. She's the producer, co-writer, and director of this award-winning documentary film, Ringer's Lord of the Fans, which has Dominic Monaghan as our narrator. And that was a little project that TheOneRing.net made a number of years ago. And so you might recognize Peter from many, many places, but let's come around to what's the most important thing. To me, at least, as an animation fan.
Hello, Jean Bourgeois.
The animation of The Hobbit in the 70s was done by Rankin and Bass.
Right.
And they made this movie, too.
Okay, so
Rankin and Bass made The Hobbit.
The first film version of anything Tolkien was The Lord of the Rings by Ralph Bakshi, written by Peter S. Beagle.
Actually, the very, very, very first...
Don't get technical!
Okay. But you're not... What you said was not quite fact. I've got to fact check. Since I've been watching the presidential debates, I've been fact checking everything I hear, and I'm fact checking you. The very first Hobbit adaptation was by Rankin and Bass, and they also got their Japanese animators
to
work
Tolkien
on The Last Unicorn.
So what was the first Tolkien movie?
The first Tolkien movie in America, English language, was The Hobbit by Rankin and Bass.
I thought Lord of the Rings came out first.
No. 2 years later.
Are you sure?
Absolutely. United Artists theatrically released The Lord of the Rings a couple of years after The Hobbit was telecast on television.
No, I thought the television came after.
Nope. Sorry. Okay. You're close, though. You're close.
All right, so the screenwriter of the animated Lord of the Rings also wrote the Hobbit version? The Hobbit? Animated
no.
Hobbit?
No, that's not what I said. The animators from Rankin and Bass, who did Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, who did The Year Without a Santa Claus, you know, those great holiday specials that everyone loves? Rankin and Bass, you know, Little Drummer Boy, and all that stuff? They did The Hobbit animation, and they did The Last Unicorn. And it's a very, very good adaptation of The Last Unicorn, and it stars none other than Christopher Lee as the villain of this film.
Huh.
It's really, really cool. So there's a lot of
connections.
Super connections, yeah. I mean, if you want to get back into the 70s mode of where fantasy was, they weren't doing that many live-action things, like Peter Jackson so ambitiously would do years later. It was all about the animation. And for all you Miyazaki fans, you might know that most of this team of animators who did The Hobbit animated and The Last Unicorn for Peter Beagle, well, they went on after working on these shows, and they moved over to work with Studio Ghibli and started working with Miyazaki. As a matter of fact, just as a point of reference for you animation fans. So we're going to be talking to Peter Beagle. And, you know, there's some things that he's not going to be allowed to say on the air because there's an existing lawsuit going on right now.
Oh, I think I've heard about that.
We need to get into this story, and Peter's not going to be able to talk about it live while he's on the air. But we are allowed to talk about it live when he is not on this phone call with us.
So we want to talk to him because he's got new work out. He's got new books out.
It's the most exciting book. I love this book. I read this book 5 years ago. Maybe it was a little bit longer, maybe 7 years ago, when it was an early draft. And it is an ideal film that we want to make. I'm just not going to get into that, but it's such a great book, and there's just something about, you know, that story that I really love, and the producer in me wants to option, maybe someday as a dream, I would like to take his
book. I don't remember any of his early work, and I probably, I don't know if I would like it. The Last Unicorn looks kind of too feminine for me. But I do remember seeing that he...
No, it's not. It's just the feminine part of The Last Unicorn is that she herself is transformed into a human, a delicate, beautiful woman who isn't quite aware of who she is. She's losing her memory, and she is the very last unicorn, and she is in this story in danger of never being able to turn back to who she really is. And
oh, wait, I think I supported Peter. He had a Kickstarter a couple years ago, right? He wanted to tour with this movie?
He did. He did a nationwide tour.
He did a nationwide tour where he went around and he met up with fans, and he had like film cells for sale in the lobby and everything like that.
Yes,
I remember that. And I felt so wonderful supporting an accomplished guy who obviously had made a lot of people happy, like you happy in your childhood. And I thought, you know, guys like that don't get a lot of work nowadays. So what a way to that I can support a guy like that. So I think I donated to his Kickstarter.
You did. That's great.
And then we went to his showing in the OC, and I think I bought a film cell or a T-shirt.
Yeah, that's right.
I, not being a big fan, I just wanted to support a creative, mm-hmm. you know, a guy that had brought, you know, joy and happiness to so many people. And of course, you know, the Lord of the Rings connection with working with Ralph Bakshi.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess I was a little discouraged or disheartened to read recently that there's a website called Fans Against Fraud.
Fansagainstfraud.com. Yes.
And it explains everything in more detail than my little brain can handle. But turns out that all the money that was generated from that Kickstarter and all the money from all of those film cells mm-hmm. that were sold, animation cells, and all those T-shirts that you guys bought while he was on tour. And he also went to conventions, right? We saw him at New York Comic Con a couple of years ago.
Yeah, we've seen him at San Diego Comic Con
years
in a row.
Yeah, he's been to so many. And people in the chat room are saying, I met him in 2006. I met him in 2008 at a Comic Con. I guess a lot of that money that we thought we were supporting him didn't actually make it back to Peter S. Beagle.
There's a problem. That's the problem.
And so that there's some legal things happening because all of the support that the fans have given to Peter S. Beagle at every convention, on Kickstarter, during the tour, did not make its way back to the author himself. And, you know, living ain't cheap, and getting older ain't cheap. You know, just to ask my grandparents about, you know, their medical bills and whatever, you know. I think everybody thought they were helping to support Peter S. Beagle in the twilight of his career, and it turns out the money didn't get to him. So I think there's a bunch of legal stuff. Of course, he can't talk about it,
right?
But you know, we can tell fans about this website, Fans Against Fraud. Mm-hmm. It's a lot of words on his website. It's very confusing. It took me like a few days to like really understand what the website was all about.
Yes. Well, let's crystallize it for you, and we'll try to get the dirty dirt out of the way so that we can focus on the positivity and the things that we want to do to help Peter.
He sounds wonderful.
He's fantastic. We need to get some context here. Peter Beagle, whom I have known for many, many, many years.
Hi, Loretta.
I've interviewed him here for Ringers. And yes, thank you, Oscar, in the Facebook Live chat for saying that The Last Unicorn is a great movie. Sir Christopher Lee plays a vital character in that film. Indeed, he does. Unlike other fantasy, there's a lot of existential angst in The Last Unicorn. There is a lot of existential angst. And it's a really fantastic theme that underlies this fantasy story, which is unusual in a lot of modern, you know, 20th century fantasy stories. And the crisis, the crisis of identity, I think, may be appropriate right here for Peter's situation, because Peter has always been so closely associated with a business partner who has done him wrong, and a guy who has, who had created a website called Conlan Press. And that is the website that you guys should no longer ever go to. And that is the most important thing that I want to tell you. Hello, Pete. Hello, Ellen. Hello, all of our usual friends here in the chat. But if you want to support Peter Beagle, and we're all true fans of him, you want to make sure that you never buy any posters or any DVDs or Blu-rays or any copies of books from Conlin Press, because that is the person who Peter actually is in the middle of a lawsuit with to extricate himself from, you know, the very bad things that have been going on. And if you want Peter to actually get a bit of the royalties that he very much deserves, then you're going to have to go to Tachyon Publications. I'll spell that out for you.
That's so confusing. It is not confusing.
Just make sure that the most important...
It's on fansagainstfraud.com.
Yeah, the deal can be explained in much more details.
And they have links to the safe places to purchase.
They do. But you can look up Fans for Fraud. You can go right to Fans for Fraud.
Fans against fraud.
Fans, is it fans against? Sorry.
Yeah,
that's
fans
right.
are not
that's
for
I,
fraud.
That's what I meant to say. Thank you.
Unless you're on Facebook and you're selling bootleg t-shirts.
The most important message that I can deliver today before we begin our interview with Mr. Beagle is do not buy anything from Conlin Press. Because if you do, you're putting money in the pockets of someone that Peter is caught up in a lawsuit with, and you're not helping the author at all. And it's kind of tricky and weird, and we're going to talk about Summerlong, an extraordinary new story, a new novel that Peter has released through Tachyon Publications. You can get details about that
and
at Fans Against Fraud.
And
yes.
from what I remember understanding, because, you know, you communicated with Connor when we interviewed him before, Peter S. Beagle before, through Connor. Connor was a big fan. I mean, he was like the ultimate fanboy. He was presented as the ultimate fanboy. And it's our understanding, according to the website, that, you know, it kind of endeared him to the author. And here's a guy who's an ultimate fan that has a little bit of business sense that says, let me help you become greater. You know, let me help you. And this is what happens in Hollywood all the time. This is what happens everywhere. Agents, managers, people come up to kids, adults, out-of-work actors of all ages and say, I'm going to make your career bigger and better, and I'm a big fan of your work.
Yes.
I mean, that's a tale as old as time.
Yeah, and he ended up being an interloper who had his own agenda and is trying to take control of assets and take control of things that are not his to control, and they belong to Peter, and it's all about ethics, business ethics, and I'm not going to get too further down that rabbit hole, but we love Peter Beagle, we always have, because he's connected to our history of appreciating the Lord of the Rings.
Mm-hmm.
He's published in every Ballantine Books paperback edition in North America and Canada, with his opening introductory note. And Peter Beagle is a great guy. And if you want to get a taste of some really, really good fantasy authorship that's not from England, you know, I'm an Anglophile. Love my British authors, Pullman, Tolkien, and of course, Terry Pratchett. I love all that stuff. But if you want a really good American, and of course, J.K. Rowling. I love J.K. Rowling. But if you want some good American fantasy, smack, smack, smack. You want to get Peter S. Beagle. He's the best. And we're going to bring him on, and we'll be talking with him live just a bit.
So the cool thing is that now, you know, now there are actual, you know, there are more direct ways to support your author. So many people in the chat room. Heather says, I met Peter at New York Comic Con 2 years ago. He is so wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
Ellen Design met him at San Diego Comic Con and got her copy of The Last Unicorn signed. There's movies, there's books. There's so many wonderful things. He enjoys signing, enjoys talking with people.
Mm-hmm.
And he, you know, he put in the work. It's a lot of work going to all these conventions.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the One Ring goes to all these conventions. Sean Astin has been crushing it on the convention scene. He's everywhere. Hillywood Show, they were in, you know, Australia a week ago, and then they were Kamikaze this week. And so, you know, Peter S. Beagle, travel gets harder the older you get, so it's wonderful that he's still on the scene and he's still communicating with fans.
Thank you, Andrew Morris. Sorry to interrupt, my friend. Thank you, Andrew Morris,
on
the Facebook chat.
On Facebook, yeah.
That is exactly... Look at our Facebook chat right now, everybody.
Tachyon Publications.
Tachyon Publications. That is exactly where you're going to go to buy a copy of Summerlong. Now, let me tell you a little bit about Summerlong.
And just for
it's
the record...
It's such a good book.
And,
I really like this.
And just for the record, we were notified earlier today that the Twitter account... Peter S. Beagle at Peter S. Beagle.
Is not run by Peter.
Is not by Peter. In fact,
it's
Peter.
In the clutches of he who shall not be named.
As far as we know, maybe you can ask Peter about this. As far as we know, he is very. He doesn't have a lot of technology. He doesn't tweet and Instagram and Facebook on the regular. I believe he uses a typewriter, an old school typewriter.
He's a writer from the 60s. From the heyday of Berkeley. I mean, this guy, get a computer. He's so OG.
We tried to book him for a Skype, and he couldn't even Skype with us.
He says he's going to be getting actually a whole new computer system coming up soon.
Okay.
In a couple of weeks. Maybe we'll get him on the show again.
He's not a complete Luddite.
No, not a complete Luddite. But, you know, can you imagine a cast like Alan Arkin, Angela Lansbury, and Mia Farrow.
Is Jeff Bridges in that too?
Jeff Bridges, yeah. Jeff Bridges, Alan Arkin as Schmendrick, the magician, and a wonderful, wonderful cast of characters.
Tiffany says she met Peter through Cliff because Tiffany in the Facebook chat is your sister.
That's my beautiful younger sister. Tiffany, hello, Tiff. I love you.
You have a sister?
I have two sisters. And an older brother. Yep.
Where are they?
Four children.
They're not here. I've never met them.
Well, they're in different parts around the country. And there's Tiffany in the chat. Say hi to my sister. She's fantastic. Now, let me tell you something, okay? The Last Unicorn is the most obvious immediate reference point to Peter Beagle, but he has written many other exceptional books and short novellas. And especially take a look at the book called A Fine and Private Place. It's set in a graveyard, in a cemetery, and it's a really beautiful meditative book. The Last Unicorn, as it is trapped in, it's not trapped, but it is in the trappings, that's what I meant to say, it is in the trappings of traditional fantasy, but there's a much more interesting philosophical and existential argument going on here in The Last Unicorn, and I really dig it. So, hello, Scott.
Hendrick says, in the Facebook chat, Hendrick says, I didn't know if Peter S. Beagle had just ordered The Last Unicorn to support. That's wonderful.
Oh, that's great, Hendrick. Thank you, Hendrick. That's great. Make sure that you ordered it from Tachyon Publications. Don't order anything from Conlon Press. Just gotta say that.
And we have so many new people on Twitter, on Periscope,
on
Facebook. Again, if you're
just joining us,
Torrent Tuesday, we do this every Tuesday. Today, we'll be talking with Peter S. Beagle on the phone. You'll call him in a couple minutes.
Yes.
And just to remind everybody, he's the screenwriter behind the original animated Lord of the Rings.
Yeah, that was released in 1978 by United Artists.
And then to further the Tolkien connection, the animators that did The Hobbit
in 77.
Television special.
No, that's true. It was 76 or 77 when Star Wars came out, and The Hobbit was on ABC, National Television.
The Hobbit was a television special on ABC. And so the next movie that animation house did was an adaptation of Peter's book called The Last Unicorn. This came out in 1982.
It's really good, by the way. It's really quite good. And Christopher Lee is really, really, really,
wow,
really good.
Wow, another connection. So many Tolkien connections
to him. There are indeed. And there's also a Miyazaki connection, because this entire animation team that was working for Rankin Bass, they moved over to start working with a brand new studio called Studio Ghibli, which was just being formed. And Miyazaki brought a lot of those animators
over. Northerners in the chat room says, I could not put The Last Unicorn down. That's a really wonderful thing.
Hey.
And so many people in the chat room are saying, I met Peter at the first Creation Entertainment Lord of the Rings con. What was that called? You had a convention? Creation Entertainment?
It was called ORC, the One Ring Convention.
Really?
ORC. We were called ORC, the One Ring Convention. Yes, that's exactly what it was called, ORC.
Oh, that's wonderful.
What a bad name for a really good convention, ORC. No, we ain't had nothing but maggoty bread for 3 stinking days.
That's
what everybody talked like at the convention.
Andrew Morris in the chat room says, I used to post a lot to Torn, but he also wanted us to mention that there is a fundraiser, he believes, to help Peter's lawyer's fees. Again, this is a very complicated, convoluted legal case, and lawyers are not expensive. And look,
that's right.
You know,
lawyers are not expensive.
Peter is going around the country signing $20 DVDs and $20 books at a time.
And not getting that money.
Plus, plus the cost to travel and everything like that.
Yes, I know.
So, so there's so many ways, but we want to focus today on the books that you've been scrolling behind us.
Yeah,
he's got so many wonderful.
There's a short story collection, The Line Between. I want to talk about Summer Long.
Would you say
I'm so eager about that?
Would
film
you say he is
book
one of the best living fantasy authors right now?
He is one of the smartest. He's one of the smartest.
Not like
authors
a lot of young adult fantasy, which is getting into made all these movies
no
and television
series.
No.
Those young adult books
so
are like
this is high level fantasy.
Yeah, that's not like Color by Numbers. Those YA books like The Maze Runner, blah blah blah. That's like Color by Numbers. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking
Mortal
about
Instruments.
The Mortal Instruments.
Divergent.
Like, Insurgent. Regurgent, that's what I call it.
Percy Jackson.
I call it regurgent. Now, but there's a tip of the hat to Greek mythology. I'm glad you mentioned Percy Jackson. But Summer Long is a new story, and it is a very calm and beautiful little fable about a girl who may...
This girl.
A mysterious girl.
A girl. Two girls.
A mysterious girl who appears... right off the coast of Washington State, where they have the islands, and the people who live there have to get in a kayak to go across the sound. Puget Sound. You guys know where Puget Sound is. And, of course, my sister, Tiffany, lived in the Seattle area for a long time, and she knows the area. But the characters are in Seattle, and they're on these little islands that are right off the coast, and all of a sudden, a strange, mysterious girl arrives. Very much like Eleven. You know when Eleven shows up in Stranger Things?
Spoiler.
And you're like,
spoiler.
Who is she? She's not properly dressed. You don't know who she is. She doesn't seem to talk much. And you wonder, who is this mysterious girl?
She looks
where does
like
she come
she's
from?
Made of twigs, like her hair.
Is that
very...
the cover of Summer Long?
Yeah.
That new one? It's beautiful. Now, when she shows up, all of a sudden, the cold weather changes and it becomes warmer again around, and the characters who are living on these islands are like, what are we going to do with this? What are we going to do with this strange young woman who doesn't seem to have a past or a future or a family? And who is she?
Sounds like my brother.
But she possesses great and powerful magic, and the way that Peter Beagle handles magic is all subtlety. It's all about subtlety. Maybe it's a thing that he picked up from J.R.R. Tolkien, maybe, but because Tolkien says that, you know,
there's nothing subtle about...
Do not meddle in the affairs of wizards, for they are subtle and quick to anger, unquote. One of the most famous quotes from Tolkien. Don't tell me that Tolkien doesn't know about subtlety. So when Summer Long, as a story, starts to progress, you realize that there may or may not be Greek mythological elements, and these characters who suddenly start appear may or may not be Persephone, and the guy who's coming to get her back, he may or may not be Hades himself. Remember the story of Persephone? She gets taken from the world and goes underground and is taken by Hades, the lord of the underworld, and that's when winter happens. That's the Greek mythology story.
Okay.
Winter comes from when Persephone leaves and has it taken to the underworld, and that's when all the springtime and the flowers and the warmth of the world, all the sunshine and warmth, leaves. But when you read Summer Long, you'll start to realize, what would it be like if this extraordinary woman actually reappears in present-day Puget Sound, and you wonder, what's going on? And it's just such a cool story. I love Summer Long. Super, super good stuff. And it has such a delicate storytelling quality. And I really enjoyed it. It doesn't have the Sturm und Drang that you get from Lord of the Rings or other hardcore Tolkien works. Mm-hmm. It has a lot of subtleties. It's really lovely. So why don't we talk to the man himself about his new book, huh?
Okay.
Why don't we try to reach Mr. Peter Beagle and talk about Summer Long? Are Cliff and Justin seeing this? Yes, Emily.
Yeah.
Hello,
we're
Emily.
We're watching all the chats.
We see all the chats, and we're very glad to see you. Great to have you here. And Emily, you're our friend calling all the way from England. We have a friend in Wales, Kieran. He may or may not show up. And there's a whole bunch of people from around the world.
It's always wonderful to see where everybody is from in the chat rooms.
It is. It's great. We
multiple chat rooms.
I love it when we get fans from South America and Brazil. And I'm telling you what, I have a soft spot in my heart for a veteran fantasy author who has so much under his belt, writing for Star Trek, The Next Generation, you know, writing for Gene Roddenberry, writing for Tolkien, and doing a rewrite for Ralph Bakshi and doing the Lord of the Rings script, mm-hmm. and then having his thoughts published in every copy of Fellowship of the Ring that every child read in America, and The Last Unicorn, which is such a thing of beauty, and now all of a sudden, Peter Beagle's in a mess where he's not getting the money that he deserves. And
but he's still writing. Look,
he's
at the end of the day,
he's still writing. He's still kicking. And he's amazing. Look, he's just an amazing guy.
Vincent Van Gogh died broke. I mean,
So did Edgar Allan Poe.
Vincent Van Gogh, he was roommates with Gauguin.
Mm-hmm.
And then
Gauguin.
And he was getting 100 franc allowance every month.
Do you want one?
No.
Okay.
So artists just want to create, and Peter S. Beagle just wants to create, and he keeps writing. A guy like that, he just wants to focus on the creativity.
I'm calling him now, but I don't hear anything. Oh, there it is. There it is. There it is.
Let's see if he can hear us.
Well, hello, Peter Beagle. Are you there?
I am. That's an interesting question. It's not defined there.
Can you guys hear him? Can everyone raise your hands in the class if you can hear him?
Can he hear you?
Yeah, you can hear me just fine, don't you, Peter?
Yes.
Yeah? Oh, there you are. Okay. Yeah, that's good. I hear you just fine, too. I'm going to make sure that the audience, Justin, he's going to check the audio feed and make sure that everyone can hear you. And what's really funny, in case you didn't hear him, I said, hello, Peter, are you there? And he said, that's funny. Can you define here? Peter, I love it. I love it. I love it. I love talking to you because you always get to the outside margins of the words, and you always get to the most amazing conclusions sometimes. I just love it. I love talking with you.
That has to do with kind of training, because my best friend and I, who's a painter whom I've known since we were 5 years old, and I had very strange conversations until one of us would finally say, what are we talking about? And the other would say, I thought you were keeping track. But when I came to visit him, we'd been separated for a long time. He lives in upstate New York.
Yes.
And his son told me after I'd been there for a while, you know, we love our dad, but we always used to think he was just a little bit nuts. Now you're here, and I realized, no, he wasn't nuts. He was just carrying on a conversation with somebody who wasn't there. Now it makes sense.
God, I've been known to do that myself a few times.
Of course. I'm not surprised.
Peter Beagle, am I giving too much away? Are you watching us live right now?
I'm sorry?
I don't know if you had been watching on a separate monitor at your home, but have you seen any of the chit-chat that we've had so far? I was just explaining to the eager audience a little bit about the plot of Summer Long, and the delicious connections to some of my favorite Greek mythology. Yeah.
Yes. I'm sorry, tell me again, please.
I was just saying, I hope I didn't give away too much, because I was talking about the connections between one of my favorite pieces of Greek mythology and the way that you handle Summer Long. And there's this, as always, there's a very lyrical quality to your writing, and the way that we explore the changes in the weather and the subtleties of the magic as it starts to take effect throughout these people's lives when this young woman shows up. I love it. I just love it. I'm just praising your work left and right. So that's all I'm doing.
I've been very grateful when a lot of people have spoken of my sense of place, you know, of the Pacific Northwest, an island off Seattle, and so on, because I always feel other people are much better at it than I am. I love writing dialogue and creating characters, but I'm always uneasy about whether I can make people see the place I'm writing about. I can remember having a long discussion with Ursula Le Guin, who's an old friend, when she said that she loved creating worlds. That was fun. What she hated was supplying dialogue for the people who inhabited those worlds. And I think she does very well, not better than I, but for me, it was the other way around. I work out of voices in my head. I've told audiences that because I'm a writer, I have a license to listen to voices in my head.
Yes.
Otherwise, I'd be, you know, quietly taken off to Fantasy Island, where I won't get hurt or bother anybody. But if I don't hear the voices in my head, everything else is secondary. I have to hear people talking.
Indeed.
And then once I do, I'm on the right track. But I'm very pleased that I've made the place where Summerlong is happening as real as I possibly could.
You have. The place where Summerlong is happening is just as real as it could possibly be. You inspired me to do research into the underground tunnels that are underneath the Seattle. I had no idea that all this mischief was going on there. And it really is, it's very evocative of place and time. And I want to bring you into the chat room here, even though you cannot see them. Maybe I can translate for you, Mr. Beagle. I'm looking at a screen, and on this screen I can see a variety of people. They have gathered from around the world, and a lot of them are saying, I'm so glad that I made it here for Mr. Beagle and this little chat with you. A lot of people are very enthused. They can all hear you just fine. And they're saying things like, oh, he's quite witty. Yeah, everyone can hear you. They love you. And I'm gonna speak to the audience right now. Hey, everybody. We're live, so use Facebook or theonering.net/live, and you can come into the chat room, bring your questions or your comments for Mr. Peter S. Beagle. He's right here, live, and I will read what you have, and I'll make sure that you can hear it. One fan says, it is a pity that great artists find themselves in this kind of a mess. Now, I agree with that 100%.
I can't swear to being a great artist, but I can swear to being very foolish and far too trusting. I'm comforted by either knowing or knowing of other artists of all sorts who have gotten into worse messes because they weren't paying attention.
If there's one thing
I'm bound to learn before I shuffle off, I plan to live a long time. My mother made it to over 100.
Oh, please, yes, please, yes.
I plan to learn to pay attention, to be mindful.
Indeed. Well, what did they say in the newspaper business? A long time ago, they used to say the devil's in the details, right?
Yeah, yes, perfectly true.
Yes, indeed. So if somebody wants to... let me just start by asking you a general question. Do you prefer to write short stories or shorter novellas, or do you like to write longer form stories? What I've noticed through your beautiful career is that you've never gone for the route of writing a trilogy or a set of five big books that are all part of a matched story. It seems that you have a liking for smaller formats.
I know that I never feel that I have enough to say that's worthy of a big, fat doorstop of a book. Very simply, novella is probably my natural form.
Yes.
Although I was very pleased to discover these last years that I was able to write short stories.
Ah.
Because I've always regarded, how can I put this? I've always thought of the novel in a way as the idiot's form. Because if you blow a short story, if you just go off on the wrong track, even for a little bit, it's over. You've lost it. But with a novel, and I've found that true of some great novelists, you can screw up, you can do things wrong, and if somehow the power of the book is in you, you can get away with it. One of my father's favorite writers was Theodore Dreiser, who's the least stylish of stylists, the least stylish of writers, drive you crazy. But he had a gift for beating you to death with details. He finally gave up and just accepted. The same way my father's favorite, I think all told, was Joseph Conrad. And he hooked me on Conrad early on. But to this day, I will reread a novel of Conrad's, like Lord Jim or All Mayor's Folly,
yes,
and just shake my head saying, Jim, I don't care if this is your third language, as it was, I don't care if you're just writing this in the deep watches of the night as a sea captain, but you're going to lose, keep up with the syntax, and you're going to lose your entire audience in page 10, by page 10.
Yeah.
And by page 10, of course, he's got me again, and I'm just reading. Conrad could do that.
Indeed.
But the short stories, I've always felt, I'm going to be very careful. I blow this and it's over.
I know, it's hard.
So maybe the novella length just turns out to be a natural one for me.
Yeah, I envy comic book writers because they manage to walk that tightrope line between both a short story, because they've got to get the story done in 24 pages every month,
right.
But then they have to serialize their story and keep a very, long list of bullet points and story points that they need to hit over a 10 or 12 month period. So what they're really doing is both. They're both short stories, individually contained, and they're also much longer format stories. And I really don't
know. A longer arc, as they say, yeah.
Exactly. I just don't know how comic book writers do it. It impresses me all the time.
I don't myself. Yeah, I would never dream of trying that because I think it's such a work all by itself. It's, as you say, it's not neither one thing or the other, it's all of them. And so, and always, there's the haunting feeling that I always had, I don't know what this is I'm doing, but it's not a real book. Other people are writing real books. What am I doing with this ghost story? And I've always been a little discomforted, or disconfident, is there such a word? Disconfident.
Unconfident? Yeah.
Yeah, something like that, because I'm always reminded of the French actress, Simone Signoret, with a very good memoir called, both in French and in English, it's called Nostalgia Isn't What It Used to Be. and she talks about starting a play or a movie, just beginning to feel her way into the role she's supposed to play. And she said, I always want to tell them, whether it's a movie producer or people putting on a play, look, if this isn't the way you want it, I can try it another way, or I can give you your money back. And then the movie comes out, or the play goes on, and the reviews are very good, and it's going to run for a while. And I think, well, Senior A pulled it off one more time, but sooner or later, somebody's going to find out that you can't act. And I understand that very well. I do.
Very true indeed. We have a quick question here from the chat room, and it is...
Still up?
Are you there?
Hang on just a second.
Sure.
What do you need? I'm not seeing the questions, but... Yeah, of course.
Go ahead, Cliff.
One quick question is, who is your favorite author, or what is your favorite book? Thank you. That's from Emily. She's staying up really late at night in the United Kingdom. It's almost 2 in the morning, but she's part of the live show right now. She says, what's your favorite book or author? And then the next question is from Sarah. She says, The Last Unicorn has been a big part of my life, and thank you so much for creating it. How did you research it? Find these myths and stories about unicorns, like maidens being led to their true love by a unicorn. So one question about who's your favorite author, and the other question is, how did you research your stories about unicorns and that those Northern European tales?
It's hard to say. My favorite author varies, something very strikingly, with who I'm reading. For instance, right now, I've discovered a writer named Michael Gruber, Gruber. Mm. He's about my age, about 75, 76. He lives up in Seattle. Mm. And when I read a novel of his called Night of the Jaguar, I just stopped in my tracks. My immediate reaction was, is it too late for me to go into another line of work? It absolutely knocked me over. And I rarely want to bother to meet other writers. Some are friends, but it doesn't matter to me if I never meet them. Now, obviously, it's hard to, I don't particularly, want to meet, let's say, Shakespeare, who I admire enormously. Mm. I don't know what I'd say to him. But in any case, with Gruber, I just had an uneasy feeling we have to talk. And I don't know if I ever will, although, as I say, he lives up in Seattle.
Hey, we'll set this up. He's probably watching the show right now. Mr. Gruber, if you're around, Peter S. Beagle would like to break bread with you and talk, shop. That would be great.
Well, yeah, if I can. There are questions I need to ask, certainly.
Of course, of course.
And my favorite book varies enormously. There are people who simply knock me over at the time I'm reading them. Mm. I'm always expecting, you know, the next one, because I'm very dismissive, but on the other hand, you know, I'm in awe of somebody who's doing what I'd like to do. That's always that. Wow. I had a dear friend whom I never met, an English novelist named Diana Norman. Mm. We wrote to each other a couple of times a week. She was wonderful, both as a correspondent and as a novelist. To this, I started writing to her when I read a novel that she had set in the 12th century.
Ooh.
that I wanted to write. And she'd already done it, and done it much better than I ever could have. So I wrote to her at her website, "You cost me a book." And she wrote back. And we corresponded until she did the dirty on me and died. But to this day, I will reread one of her books and just shake my head. Yeah, what the hell, Diana? How did you do that? I can't do that. Like that. And we used to talk shop in our emails to a degree. So,
yeah.
And I mentioned once that I have a real problem with my villains because I tend to feel sorry for them. Yeah. And Diana immediately wrote back, "Oh, I can't do that. I can only do psychos." And she did some really scary psychos.
Really? Wow.
Oh, yeah. But if you can find it, Diana Norman, who also wrote as Ariana Franklin, it must be some, you know, English listeners to this broadcast who would know her work.
Oh, yes.
But damn, she knocks me over to this day. I miss her.
Oh, wow. That's great stuff. I'm going to have to look into that. I have a lot of affection for British things, you know, British films, you know, the Archer Studios and Powell and Pressburger films from that time. I love British cinema and obviously Tolkien and British writers. Mm-hmm. And I was reminding my audience before we got on the air with you that of the American writers, I have a much shorter list of who my favorites are, and you're right at the top. I don't know where Neil Gaiman sits on that list, because originally he's English, but he's been an expatriate and lived in Wisconsin. Yeah, he's been living in Wisconsin for so many decades now.
Yes, I know.
Yeah, I consider him an American instead of a British author at this point.
Well, whether he's British or American, he's a very sweet guy.
He is. He's a super sweet, wonderful fellow. Now, back to the question about unicorns. Did you do a lot of research, or did you decide that you had, you know, carte blanche to make up some of your own mythic fabric?
I'll tell you a funny thing. I started that book in the summer of 1962, when I was 23.
Wow.
And I was sharing a cabin with my painter friend, Phil, in Cheshire, Massachusetts.
Oh, yes.
He was painting every day, and I had started, I'd spent a whole year at Stanford in a writing fellowship, writing a novel that, thank God, will never see the light of day.
Oh, my God, are you kidding? An unreleased Peter Beagle book? Oh, come on.
Bloody mess. Not good bits in it. But anyway, the idea of the unicorn took hold in me for some reason, and I jumped on my motor scooter and went to that's how we got around that summer.
Yeah.
And that's how we came from New York to California the next year. But in any case, I went to the nearest library, which was in Pittsfield, Massachusetts, and looked up unicorns. All I found was one reference to unicorns in an encyclopedia. Mm. And all it said, really, beyond the obvious horns and cloven hooves, all it said was that Dr. Alfred Dapper saw a wild unicorn in the Maine woods in 1673. So I dedicated the book in part to Dr. Alfred Dapper.
Oh.
And then many years later, I discovered that Alfred Dapper, who was was a Dutch con man who wrote very successful books in, where the hell was he? Not living in Holland, but he'll come to me, trying to remember the city. All I know is that he wrote a lot of books on places he'd never been. He wrote books, he wrote a book about America, wasn't very well known, obviously, at the time. And he wrote books about Japan and China and India, to none of which he'd ever been. So I felt liberated to make up a story about him.
Right.
And one of my favorites in my own stories is called Alfred Dapper's Day. He's needed to jump on a ship, get the hell out of Holland because he swindled too many people. And he finds himself in a wretched little colony called No Popery, in Massachusetts, or what will be Massachusetts.
Yeah.
Rather Maine, excuse me, Maine, when it was called Sagadahawk.
Yes.
And everything terrifies him. Everything's too big, from the weather to the animals. But the weird thing is that he's accepted as a doctor, which is perfect. He did a year or so of medical school, but he doesn't know anything. And he makes one friend there, an Abenaki Indian.
Ah.
His name means rain coming. And rain coming does give him, point out to him a number of medicinal plants, which actually work when he applies them, and which help give him a reputation of being a real doctor.
Uh-huh.
And he's very grateful, and he would like to do something nice for his friend by way of recompense. But all he can think of, being who he is to offer to teach rain coming to cheat at cards.
Cheat at the game of darts.
Which is completely useless.
Yes.
Abenaki, rain coming thinks he's already won the game just by showing up. But anyway, I had a lot of fun with that story.
It is. That is a fun story.
But as far as research on unicorns goes, I know a good deal more now than when I started writing the book in 1962. Back then, I just flew by the seat of my pants and hoped it would come out all right. But I've never had a harder time with a book. Everything else, by contrast, was downhill.
Really? So that was the hardest thing you ever wrote, The Last Unicorn?
When I think about it, yes.
Wow.
And the trick, of course, as with anything, whether it's playing guitar or playing center field or anything in between, of course, is to make it look easy.
Yes.
And as a friend of mine, a very good novelist, says, I go straight through, never looking back, charge along till I get to the end. Then I go back and make it look as though I always knew what I was doing.
Exactly. Well, you do. Somehow, you manage to finesse that every time, my friend. No doubt.
Well, that's what it comes to. It's painting myself into a corner and then having to think my way out. I don't recommend it to younger writers. I really don't. I've written one book, essentially according to plan. I thought it out in advance, as best I could, considering that books change under your hands, like mercury.
Yes.
While you're doing it.
Yes.
But my favorite of my own novels is still The Innkeeper's Song. And that one, yeah, I really did plan in advance. If you saw, since it changes voices all the way through, so I took a yellow pad of paper and drew a line down the middle. So I can, this happens in this chapter, and who's telling that part of the story? Okay, that would have to be, and so on. And it changed a lot, as I said, but if you looked at that original pad, which I still have somewhere, you'd recognize the book.
I would, indeed. Now, let me ask you to describe in your own words the story of Summerlong. Or what would you like to tell people who are curious about it? Because in the chat room, we actually have Carlene, who is so lovely to join us. And she made a comparison saying that Summerlong actually does kind of fit in a comparison to Neil Gaiman's American Gods, except it's not gore, it's not violent and gory like that one is.
Well, people have told me that. That's one of Neil's books I still don't know. Perhaps that's a good thing.
Yeah. Well, it's going to be the new TV series is coming out. They've made a series out of it.
Great. Good for Neil.
Yeah.
But Summer Long is basically about an older couple who have been an item for over 20 years.
Yes.
He's a retiring. I guess technically he's retired. One English history professor.
Yeah.
My father.
Mm-hmm.
And she's a flight attendant, mm-hmm. coming near the end of her career when she can retire and fly anywhere the airline wants to take her.
Mm-hmm.
And they've been an item for a long time without ever marrying. They don't live together.
Mm-hmm.
I took that from a couple I did know in Seattle a long time ago.
I love those two characters. He reminds me of Robert Langdon a little bit, you know, from the Da Vinci Code. But he's, you know, a retiring history professor who has such a unique look at the world and a unique perspective. And this is really interesting for fantasy stories or any story like this for our audience to explore a more mature romance between mature people, not people in their 20s, but people in their, you know, 50s and or 60s, and I just really find it fascinating. I love it.
Well, that was, you know, in a sense, easy, being mature in one sense or another, you could say. But also because I liked the characters. I enjoyed being with them, even though I think Abe has a lot of my worst habits. But
yeah.
But they become involved with a young woman who, as Abe says, looks rather as though she got to Woodstock a day late. But there's something magical about her and something strangely beautiful. And they wind up inviting her to stay in Abe's garage,
mm-hmm.
if she can clean it out,
yeah.
and find a way of heating it up. And that's exactly. She moves in.
Yes.
And something's definitely changing, almost from the moment she's there.
Yes.
The weather in the island begins to become, you know, some spring-like, summer-like. And anybody who's lived in Seattle can tell you that's not normal.
Yes, exactly.
And I honestly didn't know who she was for some time anyway. If she was somebody, but it took me a while to click in. And my favorite character in the book is probably the flight attendant, Joanna's daughter, Lily.
Yes.
Who's in the late 20s, 29, I think she says, and gay, which is not Joanna's problem. Joanna doesn't care about that, only that she has such lousy taste in women.
Yes.
And she's constantly worried about her, even though they bug each other on a regular basis. But she's known Abe almost all her life, thinks of him as Uncle Abe, in a way.
Yes.
And she falls head over heels in love with this young woman, who's the first one, really, who's ever been kind to her. And there's a scene in there, near the end of the book, where they part, where, you know, the lioness comes to say goodbye to her.
Yes.
Just a few pages, but I think it's the best love scene I've ever written.
It is.
And
it is lovely. I love it. I love this book. I can't shut up about it, but I want to remind everybody who's watching the live show that Peter is not getting anything from those other books that are being sold through his business manager that he's not with anymore, he who shall not be named. And I just want to tell everybody, just as someone in the chat room said, Peter does get all the money from Summer Long. So if you want to help out Peter, this is exactly the book you're going to love. This is exactly the book that you need to get your hands on. And you can buy it through Barnes & Noble. It's actually in the stores all around the country at Barnes & Noble. You can get a physical copy at a brick-and-mortar store. And you can also find it at Tachyon Publications, which somebody put up a link in our chat room just a little while ago. It's a beautiful love story, Peter. Summer Long is a love story, but to me, it's also, it's filled with a type of bittersweet quality that I get when I read the last chapter, The Grey Havens, at the end of the Return of the King. And it is so bittersweet, and it is not easy for any author to go into that delicate emotional space. And you did it, and you did it beautifully. And I love it.
It's also,
I love it.
I'd like to mention, because people miss this, it's funny. I can't write anything that in some way isn't funny. When I was living on that island, I had a neighbor across the stream, a commercial artist, old Fred next door. And quite frequently, I'd just step across the stream and walk in to have coffee with Fred. And it just happened that I came in once, and he was reading my nonfiction book about Phil and me traveling across the country on motor scooters called I See by My Outfit. Yeah. And Fred looked up as I came in and said, "Hey, I didn't know you were funny." And I said, What are you talking about, Phil? We had a lot of coffee together. You know I'm funny." And he said, "Yeah, I know. But I didn't know you could write funny."
Oh, come on.
I'd rather cherish that.
That's hilarious. That guy's funny. Well, you know, friends are going to rib you like that. That's great. We have another question from the live chat. Do you think that your recent work, any of your recent works, perhaps Summer Long being another point, could work as an anthology series, like American Horror Story, which changes its focal point and its characters every season? Or, you know, the way Amazing Stories, when Steven Spielberg was producing that back in the 80s, you remember that?
Yes, I do indeed.
Yeah, well, it would be cool, wouldn't it, to see some of your work adapted into an anthology TV format?
Oh, I'd love it, of course. There was always interest in my novel, Tamsin, for one.
Tamsin.
Tamsin.
I forgot to mention Tamsin. What a wonderful book. A great story. I love it.
There was a real attempt to make a series out of the one I said was my favorite novel, The Innkeeper's Song.
The Innkeeper's Song.
Which I would dearly love. That would be wonderful.
Yeah.
And I work very hard on not thinking about anything like that. Because a number of reasons. just thinking, Neil hung me up once because he referred to me as the gold standard of modern fantasy. And improbable as it sounds, that really almost froze me. I'd look at a paragraph and think, with the gold standard of modern fantasy, write that crap, and I'd start over.
Oh, gosh, wow. Was that?
It took me a while to break loose from that.
Really? Was that a compliment from Neil Gaiman?
Yeah, that was Neil Gaiman, and it was a wonderful compliment, you know, and I was honored by it. But it did hang me up for a while, trying to live up to that.
Indeed. Gosh, it's hard to get high praise. It's really hard to realize, oh, someone's giving me bigger shoes than I thought I had.
Yeah, like that. Exactly.
So let's go a little bit further down the rabbit hole. Let's talk a little bit about how many pages is Summer Long in its current form that Tachyon has published right now?
I can't be sure. I don't have it handy, but... Wait a minute, I do have it handy. Hold on.
But it's,
I know that I...
It's a little bit longer than a short novel, but it's not a large, like, you know... Like, it's not like picking up a copy of The Goblet of Fire and it's 900 pages, you know?
It runs in print, in this tech in print, 236 pages.
Oh, that's beautiful. You know, The Hobbit. The Hobbit was about 230 pages. Yeah, that sounds about right.
And... Infinitely longer as a movie.
Yeah, oh gosh. Now, that was the joke I was going to make. When Rankin and Bass Animation did The Hobbit in the 70s, they managed to do the whole damn thing in 96 minutes, which is, you know, something that Peter Jackson, could not manage to do. You know, it's funny.
Well, the temptation, once they give you that kind of money,
Yeah,
and
yeah.
that kind of space is enormous. I don't know what that would be like.
Yes.
But in the monies and trilogies. But all the same, I get very nervous if a book of mine runs longer, say, than 250 pages.
The, right.
There's a novel coming out in February, a novella, I guess, but it'll be issued as a standalone and published in hardback, which is fairly rare for Tachyon.
Oh,
and it's called In Calabria. And why it's completely different from Summer Long, and why a novel of mine should choose to set itself in the very southern tip of Italy, where I've been once in my life, passing through on a motor scooter at the ignorant age of 20, 21 or so, not knowing what I was looking at, supremely ignorant. But the story insisted, the way they do, you know, on setting itself there. And I'm very fond of it. As I say, it's completely different from Summer Long.
Ah.
But some reason there's special fondness for it. Hard to say why. And maybe it's that I particularly like the heroine. That's possible.
Indeed. What's, but, no, tell me again, Peter, the name of this book?
In Calabria. C-A-L-A-B-R-I-A. In Calabria.
Oh, in Calabria.
Calabria with an L.
Oh, in Calabria. Oh, okay.
Calabria.
In Calabria. Yeah, you guys, I'm talking to the ladies and gentlemen on the live show because that's news. That's great. You guys heard it here first, or maybe I'm hearing it here first, but Peter S. Beagle will have a new novella, a new publication coming out very early 2017 from Tachyon Publications. And it's called...
February 14th.
Oh, February 14th. Dude, that is fantastic. You can purchase Summer Long on Amazon, on Amazon.com. You can get Summer Long at Barnes & Noble if you want to get a physical copy from your local store. And definitely go to Tachyon Publications. But Peter, that's a bombshell. Thank you for sharing that news with us. We're going to have a whole new story from you in February. That's only a couple of months away.
There will also be, I believe, next year as well, a new story collection from Tachyon.
Oh.
We don't have a title for it yet.
Oh, that's great. That's great. That is so great to hear. I'm very, very excited about that.
Well, when it's the only thing you can do, and you're scratching and scrambling for a living, you better play. Better do as much as you can with it while you're still here. And
indeed.
My friend Phil and I, artist and writer, both have a similar instinct. I think it was Phil who told me this story originally of the great Japanese painter, Hokusai. Uh-huh. On his deathbed, he lived to be over 90.
Wow.
Mumbling. Damn it, I was just learning to paint.
Oh.
We all feel like that, really we do.
I know.
I'm
now,
sure most of us say that at the last.
Peter, you're so disarming. I mean, for someone with your immense talent, and for you to be so freaking humble all the time and constantly say things like, I wish I could write like that. I find that so endearing. It's just so cool. It's so funny.
Well, it's practical as well. On the other hand, back in the folk music days in Berkeley, many years ago, early 60s, there was a guy who blew through town, a banjo player, who was supposed to have developed a technique that enabled him to play faster than anybody, three times as fast. I'm cool, I'm just playing guitar, I'm not a banjo player, but I went to hear him with a banjo player, a friend of mine, and the guy did play three times as fast as anybody. No trace of soul, no soul at all, but fantastic technique. And my friend watched him for some time and finally sighed and said, wow, I'd like to know how to do that and then not do it. And there are writers I feel that way about. I admire their technique and I wish I could do it, but it wouldn't occur to me to try to do it. I don't think I could.
Indeed. Now, I'm glad you mentioned musical instruments because we just got another question from the live chat. Someone said, hey, let's talk to Peter about his guitar playing. So, very similar to Abe, our lead character in Summer Long, you are, you remind me of Woody Allen in that you have this musical career on the side. Not only are you a writer and a very accomplished with storyteller, but on the side, you love your jazz and you know how to play guitar, and the character in Summerlong, he also shares that quality with you, doesn't he?
Well, if I were ever given the choice between being, you know, really first-rate novelist and a guitar player on the level of, oh, Jerry Reed or Marcel Dadi or Chet Atkins, I would have to pause and sort of ask for the prayers of the congregation, because that's something I've always wanted to be. And I'm out of practice. I'm singing better, I think, than I used to, just because I've done it a lot, worked with groups, and listened to a lot of singers and asked questions. But my chops are in terrible shape because I haven't had a regular gig for a long time. I used to sing for 12 years back in the 70s and 80s at a French restaurant in Santa Cruz. Every weekend, a couple of nights, $25 a night, and a very good French dinner.
Nice.
And tips if there were tips. And I loved it. I loved it. It was a mask. I was frequently singing in French or Spanish or Yiddish. And it happened very often that people had no idea that I spoke English, which was lovely. It was a completely different thing.
Sure.
I played, now and then I'd play a couple of my own songs. But mostly it was songs by the French masters, Georges Brassens and Léo Ferré and Charles Aznavour and Jean Ferrat.
Yes.
The guys I learned French from.
The tradition of the Jacques Brel, the chanson.
Yeah, which is a very old tradition. It goes all the way back to about the 12th century.
Yeah.
Eleanor of Aquitaine's grandfather, I think Guillaume, what the hell was his last name, come to me. But he was, you know, a poet and had enough power in his own right as a nobleman to establish a tradition of sung poetry as distinguished, if you like, from pop.
Yes.
And for me, especially Brassens, for me, that got me. That hooked me so that I knew. I think about this these days because I saw Bob Dylan a number of times playing in Greenwich Village, where people called him Lockjaw Dylan because half the time he couldn't make out the lyrics. And there was a folk singer from Boston who told me that this guy was going to make it bigger than all of them put together. And there were people who walked into the clubs in Greenwich Village in those days, Judy Collins, for heaven's sake, Hedy List, Dave Van Ronk.
Yeah.
Dave Van Ronk. Wonderful musicians who just, Eric Anderson, people just lit up the club. And this aggravating kid whose voice I can't stand, when there are 25 better guitar players and a good dozen better harmonica players, this one is going to make it that big? And Johnny said, my friend, Johnny Murray, said, he missed the point. He's going to make it bigger than all of us put together because he wants it more than all of us put together. And he called it. He was absolutely right. I thought about that when he was awarded the Nobel.
Oh, really? Wow. No kidding.
Yeah. Have you didn't notice? Yeah. He's been awarded this year's Nobel Prize for Literature.
Yes, he was, actually. He was. Yeah. You know what? Check my brain at the door. I'm sorry. I did see the news about Mr. Dylan getting the Nobel Prize, and well, that was an eye opener and no mistake, as Samwise Gamgee would say. But that's so cool. I come here on this show to talk with you about fantasy authorship and great storytelling, and I get beautiful anecdotes from you about when you were a certain age playing guitar in a French restaurant in Santa Cruz. I just love it. I never know what kind of an amazing mix of stories and history I'm going to get when I talk to Peter S. Beagle. I love it. It's just so great. It's really beautiful. There's more chat coming up here. Peter, I'll make you aware of this question right here. Someone asked, with your familiarity with J.R.R. Tolkien, and especially keeping in mind that Peter Jackson is done with the 6 movies of Hobbit and Lord of the Rings, and that's all behind him now, what stories, particularly we're looking at the Silmarillion, but what stories of J.R.R. Tolkien would be the best to approach next as an adaptation for film or television? What do you think?
The Silmarillion is complicated, but there are some stories in there that would work very well. The one about Beren and Lúthien would really matter to Tolkien.
Of course. That's just being re-released as a new Tolkien book. There's a new Beren and Lúthien volume that Christopher Tolkien has managed to put together.
Well, he'll do that while he has breath in his body.
Oh, yes.
But,
yes.
Pictured for children, I suppose, and either animated or live, these days you could do it live, always like Farmer Giles of Ham.
Oh, yes, Farmer Giles of Ham. There you go. God, I hadn't thought about that in ages.
It's a delightful story.
It is. It's a very delightful story.
And I would go for that, certainly. Except if it, like The Hobbit, got overinflated. And if they say, once they give you that money and that space where you can do anything, it's tremendous, then the temptation is to do everything.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
But I never met Tolkien, of course, but I can remember, coming across him in the 50s. I was 15, and I read the review in the New York Times by W.H. Auden, who was a friend of his, a front-page review of The Lord of the Rings, which I'd never heard of.
W.H. Auden was one of those people who really defended Tolkien when he was getting attacked by a lot of other critics.
Yeah, like Edmund Dawson.
Yes.
Exactly. It sounded fascinating. I'd love to read it, but I couldn't find it.
Yeah.
I didn't come across it until I was about 19. At the University of Pittsburgh, found it at the Carnegie Library, snapped all 3 books up, took them back to my room, and it just literally disappeared for 3 days. My roommate, who was a very nice guy, kept the Pizza Express running. But, of course, after that, Tolkien was something that I shared with a few of my best friends, Phil, Jake, a couple of others. But it was not well known at all, and it was a private language, in a way. I can remember on our way across country, Phil and me on our motor scooters, coming through Cleveland, and our immediate response, which is unfair to Cleveland, was that, wow, looks like Mordor. And Tolkien was just there as a touchstone, and then suddenly, around 1965, it all hit. I was writing essays for Holiday Magazine at the time, and they bought most of them. But when I wrote on Spec, a piece on Tolkien, an editor turned it down on the grounds that Tolkien wasn't contemporary enough.
Oh, for heaven's sake.
So I put it away and didn't take it out again until Ian Ballantyne came to visit. We were living in a shack.
Do you mean Mr. Ballantyne?
Yeah.
So I'm talking to a generation of people on the live show who might not know, but if you bought a copy of The Lord of the Rings or The Hobbit, and you were my age growing up in America in the 70s, you bought a Ballantyne Books copy. That's all there was, right? It was the only game in town.
And Ian founded Ballantyne Books. He founded Bantam Books before that.
Oh, yes, that's right.
But in this particular case, he came to visit my shack, slept on my rickety couch, woke up in the morning with a couple of kids and looking down at him and a couple of cats in his chest. And I showed him that essay and didn't think anything more about it until sometime later when people began calling me, thanking me for, or congratulating me on having written the foreword to the Tolkien Reader.
The Tolkien Reader. That's amazing you should mention that, Peter. Someone in the chat room just mentioned it just a second ago.
Well, I called in, and he said, you mean I didn't tell you? You didn't get the check?
What?
No, Ian. No, I didn't hear a thing, and no, I didn't get the check. Oh, I'll put it in the mail right now. And he did, without question.
That's amazing. But Ian Ballantyne published your essay for the Tolkien Reader and was surprised that you didn't know anything about it. That is the best phone call to ever get from a big publisher. That's the best. That's so great.
Well, Ian was a darling old pirate. He's an honest man, certainly, but he also came from another generation of publishers.
Mm.
And I'm very proud of the fact that when he and Betty were accepted into the Science Fiction Hall of Fame in Seattle, I went up there, and accepted for them. And it's one of my great moments because I talked about them too long. I remember that. You know, I went on about them because I've known them for so long. And at the Hugo Awards, where I actually won Hugo for a novella, I saw Betty for the first time in years. And I stayed at their house in Bearsville, but it's a while. She was 90 at the time. And standing there in a gold lamé dress, and she may have been the most beautiful woman I ever saw at 90. Because she was very conventionally pretty as a young girl, and Ian used to use her as a cover model on many Ballantyne books.
Oh, right on.
But there's a certain point where the other stuff just falls away, and what you are shines through. And that was how beautiful Betty was. And my immediate reaction was, I got to have my picture taken with her. I practically fought my way through a crowd. Stand next to her.
Oh, wow. That's great. That's a great story. I love that. I have a lot of love in my heart for you, Peter Beagle. You know, I've known you for years, and I love interviewing you. But it looks like, from looking at the ticking time clock, that time is soon going to be over. So let's see if we can bring the focus back to Summerlong. I'm gonna take a quick second to tell the audience, you're looking behind me on this green screen, and we have The Line Between, a collection of stories by Peter S. Beagle, and we also have, there it is, there's the new copy of Summerlong. I'm going to move out of the way so that you guys can actually see the artwork. Look at that. That is the new cover for Summerlong. It's really extraordinary, and it's a lovely...
It is eye-catching.
It is. It's a great... The cover is great. And right there, there's Patricia McKillop on the front cover saying it's a lovely, tantalizing read. I want everybody in my audience to take a look at this. And another reminder, you guys can pick this up at Barnes & Noble, at Amazon.com, and you can certainly go visit Tachyon Publications. And if anybody's a Star Trek fan, as Peter Beagle is, and myself, you know that tachyon particles are some of that techno babble that we hear a lot in Star Trek episodes. I do love it. I wanted to remind everybody, do not buy another thing from Conlon Press. Do not buy another thing from there, period. If you want to support this wonderful author, Peter Beagle, who we're talking to, and if you would like more details on how you can help him and offer support, then please check out fansagainstfraud.com. That's my final program note on that. Peter, let me get back to you, sir, real quick. I had to do all that housekeeping because I want to make sure everybody's on point. We're picking up viewers who come in very late in the show, as you know. They might not have been with us at the beginning of the hour. So, Peter, a new book in February, a brand new publication of Summerlong, and I love me some Summerlong. What is it in the world of fantasy or comic books or sci-fi? What are you most looking forward to, Peter S. Beagle, in the coming months? Are you looking forward to Star Wars Rogue One when that's released? Or how about Doctor Strange, which is in a few days?
I'm incredibly ignorant about going on in the field. For that matter, I'm incredibly ignorant about so much of the 21st century. I had enough trouble with the 20th.
Ah, okay. And fair enough.
So, as I say, remarkably ignorant. But
no.
I'm simply I don't read or see a lot of science fiction these days for a variety of reasons, but I do keep track of Star Trek.
Oh, yes.
To see what's happening with it in its various incarnations. I'm very proud of having written the script for Star Trek The Next Generation.
Yes.
About Sarek. That's Sarek, Spock's father.
Yeah, but Mr. Spock's father, Sarek, I love, one of my favorite characters. That's so funny. I don't know what it is, Peter, but you managed to create some of my favorite characterizations for these particular people. I just don't know how you do it. That was a really great episode. You know, you've heard a lot about Axanar. Have you heard about the lawsuit that was going on between Paramount and the fans who were trying to put together that Star Trek fan film? Have you heard a bit about that?
Yes, I did hear something about that.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, I'm going to set up an introduction for you. I'm going to introduce you to my friend Bill Hunt. He's a great guy. He's been a guest on my show. And he is the screenwriter of the Axanar script. And he says it's the best thing he's ever written. And it's probably the best script that will never be produced because Paramount is being such a bear about that. And I would love to introduce the two of you. It would be great.
I'd be delighted, certainly.
Yeah.
And I must mention that my second greatest moment in show business was when I realized at a convention of book dealers and writers that gorgeous, stunning black woman over there at that table, oh dear God, it's Lieutenant Uhura. And I can't accost people. I never recognize celebrities for that matter, only her. But when we started to change tables, I lurched in front of her saying, "Ms. Nichols, I used to watch Star Trek for you. I mean, I remember episodes by how much dialogue you had or didn't have. My friends used to tease me about it." And I did a script for a later version of Star Trek, which is always true. I'm still groping for something to say. And finally, it hit me. Oh, and a friend of mine used to date your son, and which was also true. She was absolutely, absolutely charming and sweet and perfectly willing to stand there and talk until her publicity person, I guess, got nervous and wanted to move her along. And then she leaned forward and kissed me. That's the last thing I remember.
You were kissed by Nichelle Nichols?
How about that?
That is...
Come and get me, Garth.
That is the best. You know, I'm never washing these lips again. I love it. That's so great.
It was about like that. She was lovely, and I still, in her 80s, she's still lovely. But yes. I still watch old episodes of Star Trek, the old original, and yes. I find myself saying, there she is, right over there. Just linger on her a little longer.
Yes, I'm so glad she's still with us. We got to visit with her at San Diego Comic-Con just a few months ago. And that's really, everybody in the chat room is laughing and really enjoying and saying, way to go, Peter, a kiss from Uhura. That is a great story to end today's episode on. That is really a lovely, lovely story. And Mr. Peter S. Beagle, you're a gentleman and a scholar, I've got to say it. For lack of a better cliche, you're just such a great guy, and I love having you come back on the air with us. Next time, we'll do a little, technical jiggery-pokery, and we'll see if we can get you in visually to chit-chat with everyone. Andrew Morris in the chat says, "Peter, you lucky devil," with a big smiley face.
Meanwhile, thank you all for being here, and thank you, Cliff, as always, just for having me over, at the house, and just for, I'll tell one thing very quickly.
Yes.
You gave me a great moment by yourself, simply when, a couple of years back, more than a couple, I make no sense of time, but I dropped in at a post-Oscar party.
Ah, yes.
That you were emceeing, and when you saw me and mentioned, and we have here with us the author of, and it never got finished because the audience recognized me, recognized the name of the book, and just went bananas. It was stomping and screaming. It was a rock and roll audience. I've never had one of those before. And for the first time, I understood, God, if you're not careful, this could be addictive. I understand why some people can never get off the stage. It's not the money. It's not the gig.
Yep.
It's the screaming.
Yes. You're right. Yeah, I agree. When that bug bites, it's really hard for me to get off stage, too. Believe me. Trust. I know what that's like. My friend, I have to say my favorite memory, and that was great. It was really great to bring you on stage, and it was a beautiful moment of acknowledgement. I'm really glad that the fans showed their true quality for you, just like Faramir. They showed their true quality. But my favorite thing was that one night we were out at dinner somewhere with Carlene after we were shooting some footage, I think for Ringers, Lord of the Fans. And you introduced me to what became my favorite Mexican beer. I had never heard of it before. It was called Negra Modelo.
Negra Modelo.
And I mean, I didn't really know that much about different imported beers, and I had no idea that was the tastiest thing to ever come out of Mexico since guacamole. It was fantastic. And I'll always be grateful for that, Peter S. Beagle. Thank you very much. So good to have you on the show. People on the chat room saying lots of love for you, Peter. Thank you for doing this, and thank you for joining us. And Peter, very soon, hopefully before 2017 arrives, we'll have you back on the show. You are welcome here, my friend, anytime.
Thank you, Clifford. Thank you so much, and thank you all, as I say, for showing up and being at the house.
Anytime. So glad to have you, sir. We will be in touch with you again in the very near future. And I'm going to say goodnight to the whole audience and do a little bit of housekeeping. And then we'll get ready for our next week's show, which is, I'm going to remind the whole audience.